Hello everyone, this video is meant for students who are thinking of going for a PhD. Now I know that if you look around on the internet and maybe even on YouTube, you'll find a number of resources that target students who are just starting out on their PhD. There are also some resources available targeted specifically to Indian students who wish to go for PhD abroad. However, there is a lack of resources or guidance for students who wish to do their PhD here in India itself. So this video is specifically meant for those students. However, some of the things that I'm going to say, they're quite general enough that it may be beneficial to students who wish to go abroad also. All right. Now, before I get into the actual pieces of advice, I'd like to give a brief background about myself so that you can relate to my words a little bit better. So I did my undergraduate here at IIT Kharagpur in the Mechanical Engineering Department. I was a dual degree student. Subsequent to that, I immediately joined the PhD program, again here at IIT Kharagpur. And after doing my postdoc abroad, I joined as a faculty member here at IIT Kharagpur again. So it has been a long association with IIT Kharagpur. But when I'm going to share some of the pieces of advice for students who are thinking of doing their PhD, I want you to take these words more less coming from a person who is a faculty member at an IIT, and more as a person who has been through the Indian education system all throughout his life. Because I have been through it all, I have seen each stage. So I think what I'm going to say will be beneficial to you. Okay, so without further ado, let us get into the actual points. So when I first started thinking about making this video, so many different points came to my mind, and further along when I posted my last community post question, many of you gave such very thoughtful answers that eventually I ended up with so many points that I don't think I'll be able to cover them all in one video. So I have decided that I'll dedicate this video to some of the points spanning across the job prospects, some of the financial aspects, and some of the social aspects. The academic side I will cover in a separate video. Okay, so first of all, regarding the job prospects, we want to be very clear-cut about certain things. So when you are first thinking of doing a PhD, you should have in your mind why exactly you are going to start your PhD. What is the end result of this? Okay, where do you want to end up? So when I ask this question, why do you want to do a PhD? Many of you will probably answer that you want to go into the academic line. Maybe you want to become a professor. So that's the most common answer. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but you have to calibrate your expectations with the realities of life. What I mean by that? You see, every year, so many PhD students get their degrees. And the number of these PhD students getting their degrees is higher than the number of total academic job vacancies in India. Okay, so I'm specifically, so this is true, especially if you consider the top institutes, speaking from a STEM perspective, IISc, the IITs, the NITs, some good institutes, for example, here in West Bengal, like Jadavpur, IIST, Shivpur, and many other institutes, maybe some good private engineering colleges also. But you have to understand that some good level academic research is done in only a limited number of these institutes. So the question arises as to what do you want, what do you want to do? After you have done your PhD, do you want to go into a job or into a place where there will be focus on research? And there are a number of institutes, including a number of research labs also beyond the academic institutes, which provide such opportunities. Or do you perhaps want to go into a kind of job where there will be research plus teaching? Or perhaps you'll be satisfied with a job where the focus is almost entirely on the teaching with very little scope for research. So again, I say that you have to calibrate your expectations accordingly. Now, if your aspiration is such that you want to get into a great place like IISc, the older IITs, you have to understand that the competition is becoming increasingly fierce in these places. Okay, so it was always top-notch competition there, but as we move ahead in time, the competition is becoming more and more fierce. So among the huge number of students who are getting their PhD degrees, even from these places which I just mentioned, only a very, very minute fraction of them will be able to get their jobs in these institutes. And you have to understand that, so speaking about this particular institute itself, the usual line is something like this, that you have to have a very good academic record starting right from your 10th board, through your 12th board, through your undergraduate, master's level. And let's say, suppose for argument's sake, that even if it is not so stellar, but your publication record must, from your PhD, must be absolutely excellent. Okay, if you have to have any chance of getting a job in one of these places. And not just that, even beyond PhD, you have to invest about 2-3 years, 4 years time as a postdoc. Now, again, with very, very good publication. So you have to maintain and sustain that publication record all throughout your PhD, through your postdoc, and only then you can get to these places. So this is fact. And as I said earlier, if you calibrate your expectations in such a way that, okay, maybe you don't want, maybe you're happy to go into some other kinds of institutes where the focus is maybe on teaching more, then maybe you don't have to spend so much time on your postdoc, but still the competition is not light. Okay, so now, till now, the situation in India, as I said, it is becoming extremely competitive, but it is not as bad as it is in the US. Okay, which brings us to the next point, that when you are applying for these positions in these academic institutes or research labs, you have to understand that the pool of candidates is not just those students who have done their PhD in India, because the situation is so ultra, almost killer level competitive, especially in the US, that many of the students who have gone abroad, who have gone to the US for their PhD, are coming back to India in large numbers and applying for these academic positions. So your competition will be with those students also, who have done their PhDs from great places, who have a very strong publication record. So it's an open battleground like that. So these are some of the things on the job prospect side. I don't want to spend too much time on talking about job prospects in the private sector, like in the companies, but there are jobs there. But again, it's not a huge number of jobs. Okay, it's not a huge number of jobs. And you have to remember something, that on the job prospect side, that after doing your PhD, and this is very, very important, after doing your PhD, your mentality becomes such that you kind of cannot take up any and every job that comes your way. There are only certain kinds of jobs which you will feel kind of motivated to even think of taking up. Okay, so that is also something very, very important. So after your BTEC, I mean, anything goes. Okay, so you get a job, you take it up, it's fine. But after your PhD, it's not like that. Okay, and your age is also higher. So so there are those considerations also. Okay, I don't want to dwell on this anymore. I'd like to go to the next point, which is the financial thing. Well, there are two sides of the coin here. So first is that I think many of you know that in the first 2 years of PhD, you'll get 31,000 per month, and then in the subsequent 3 years, you'll get 35,000 per month. And then it's for the sixth year, it's significantly less. And so that's the reality. Okay. Now, this is a stipend. This is not a salary. So this is tax free. Now, the moment anyone hears this, it doesn't sound so bad. Actually, if you perhaps compare it with some of the starting salaries which some students get after their undergraduate, it actually sounds quite good, especially given that it is tax-free. And this, I think, I'm afraid that this is kind of motivates certain student, just this financial aspect, to go for a PhD after their undergraduate. Okay, and this is rather unfortunate. So if money is the motivating factor for you to join a PhD, and even more unfortunately, if it is something like you are not getting anything else, maybe you're not even getting a decent job, and that is why you want to get into PhD, trust me, please do not. Okay, please wait a little bit, get a normal job, even if the salary is not too much. In a few years' time, it will increase. Please do not join a PhD just because you are attracted by that stipend. Or rather, I would like to emphasize here that you should be joining PhD with the kind of mentality that, yes, if I want, I could have gotten a job which would have paid me something like 30,000, 40,000, 50,000 rupees per month, but I am sacrificing that job, that prospect, and still I'm going for the PhD. You should want to do that PhD that bad that you are sacrificing another job for that. Okay, if you have that kind of thing, then there is a good possibility that you will fight it out with the kind of struggles that a PhD student is expected to go through. Okay, you have that kind of right attitude and mentality. All right, the other side of the coin is, so again, going a little bit on the job prospect side, that let's say for argument's sake that you have done your PhD and you have done a top-notch PhD, you have gone for your postdoc, everything is good and nice, great, and you do end up becoming a professor in one of these good institutes. So what are the financial prospects on that? So you understand that maybe a senior level professor in the IITs, they will get in between 2 and 2.5 lakh per month, and that's like the highest thing currently. So you do the math. Okay, so there are many undergraduate students who in their first job, just after finishing their fourth year, get much more salary than that. So if you want to become rich, this is not the way to go. You will never ever become rich by becoming a professor. I mean, you can become like comfortably middle class and maybe even reach into that gray zone of upper middle class, but you will never become truly rich. Okay, I mean, you'll provide for your family and everything, that is fine, but it's not financially lucrative in the modern sense of the word. Okay, all right. Next is something on the social side. So what I want to say here is that, see, when you are starting on your PhD, you are somewhere in that rather long range of 23 years old to 30 years. Okay, and I'm including here certain students who may have done a job for a few years. So including all those things, I'm saying that 23 to 30 years is the time when you are actually starting on your PhD. Now, this means that by the time you are finishing up your PhD, given let's say 4 years or 5 years time, so you will be something like 27, 28, or maybe even 31, 32, something like that. So this age, 27 to 32, and remember, I am targeting here Indian students, I mean, most likely middle class students of India. This is the truth which you have to contend with, that that is the age where most Indian families start to pressurize the boys and girls to get married. Okay, and probably the girls even a little bit earlier than that. So that is something which many students, when they're starting out on their PhD, they completely shy away, like literally shy away from thinking about. But I think that is not a good thing. You have to take this thing also into account. You know what your family is like, how much support and like mental support and all these kinds of familial support they will provide to you, and how much pressure they may or may not give you, and you have to decide accordingly. Okay, and I would like to go into a little bit of more depth into this point to say that, see, suppose you have some significant other in your life, like a boyfriend or a girlfriend, something like that. I don't mean this like high school level kind of relationship, okay? Something more mature and involving more understanding. So if you have that kind of relationship going on, good. You know, by discussing with your significant other whether they will be able to support you or not, and you have to make your or take your decision accordingly. There's another point here that usually when you have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, so usually they are of the same age, the boy and the girl are of the same age. So that is also something to take into account, that in that case, and I have seen this happen with some of my friends, that there is a little bit of a more pressure on the girl's side to have the wedding done. Okay, there's nothing wrong with it, but this is something to think about. On the other hand, if you do not have a significant other in your life, so the usual tradition in India is to go for the arranged marriage. Now this is where things become a little bit dicey, because by the time you finish your PhD, remember what we talked about, the uncertainties, okay? So PhD by its very nature, the academic line, the early career stage of an academic line, this zone of PhD ending, going for a postdoc, looking for an academic job, this area is filled with uncertainty, okay? Like, it's very, very stressful. You have to go through a lot and lot of uncertainties. There are things which depend purely on luck. So it is rather a hard thing for you or your family to explain these things to many an Indian family, okay, for prospective relationships, okay? So when you go for an arranged marriage, you have to explain what the prospects are, what the situations are. So all these things that you probably understand, your supervisor understands, your friends understand, being from the academic setting, another Indian family who have never experienced anybody from their family doing a PhD, they may not understand at all. So you have to take that into stride. Many of us have faced this in our life, okay? So many people simply do not understand the nitty-gritties of academic life. You may have to hear certain unpleasant things also, okay? So those kinds of things happen. You take it from me, okay? I don't want to get into all those murky details, but they can happen. On this side, I would, like, on the job prospects and the financial and this social side, I would like to say that some people go for the option that they take up a job, they work for a few years, in the process they get married also, maybe have a kid, and then they come back to the university to start their PhD. They manage to do it well. I mean, they're matured, they know, they've seen life, so eventually they do their PhD. But for such students, there is one disadvantage, I would say, in the sense that not on the academic setting or like they have become old or anything, not like that, okay? But at least in the Indian system till now, we have the thing that for general category students, for becoming a faculty at the assistant professor level, the age limitation is 35 years, okay? So if you are coming back after doing a job for quite a few years and then doing your PhD, and then maybe you will be beyond that 35 years limit, okay? So think about that also. I think these are more or less the kind of things that I wanted to cover. I'm sure I have missed maybe a million things. So I invite you all, I request you all to please point out any other things that I may have missed. And I will try to cover the academic side of things, like what kind of mentality, what kind of academic mentality you need to have before you can think of starting to go for a PhD. So on that note, I will end this video. Thank you very much.